You ready to call the room?
The Thursday, March 3rd, 2011 meeting of the Cape Cod Commission is called to order. Could we have the roll call, please?
Barnstable, Royden Richardson.
Present.
Born, Michael Blanton. Brewster, Elizabeth Taylor. Chatham, Lynn Pluffner. Dennis, Richard Roy. Eastham, Joy Brookshire. Falmouth, Mario D. Gregorio. Harwich, Robert Bradley.
Here.
Mashpee, Ernest Vigilio.
Here.
Orleans, Peter Monger. Provincetown, Austin Knight. Sandwich, Joanne O'Keefe. Truro, Peter Graham. Here. Wellfleet, Roger Putnam.
Here.
Yarmouth, John McCormick Jr. County Commissioner, Mary Pat Flynn. Minority Representative, John Harris.
Here.
Native American Representative, Mark Harding. Governor's Appointee, Herb Olson.
Here.
I believe we have a quorum.
Thank you. Sorry. The next item on the agenda is public comment, and you're invited to come and comment on anything that is not on the agenda. Seeing no comments, we'll go on to the executive director's report.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have several things for the commission. Just want to let you know that on Monday night, the SEIC, the New Sandwich Economic Development Group, sponsored a forum for highlighting public and private partnerships, and it was very well attended in the newly redesigned Sandwich Town Hall. There were clearly over 100 people there, and the Senate President moderated, and I got a chance to participate in that panel and preview for that group a lot of the reforms that we've made over the last 3 years, and to dovetail that with opportunities for public-private partnerships in these economic centers going forward. So that was good. And then on Tuesday, we met with the State House delegation and Open Cape to give them a little update on that Open Cape process. And then met with the county commissioners on Wednesday, and we talked a lot about the NSTAR herbicide issue. We'd been negotiating with NSTAR for several months on an MOU. And yesterday, NSTAR issued a press release announcing that they were going to extend their year-long moratorium of using herbicides on the rights-of-way for another year. And that means an opportunity to finish a lot of the work that the county has started through their ad hoc committee. And that will involve looking at perfecting the mapping, a monitoring program, an education and outreach piece, and a look at sort of the aggregate impacts of herbicides, pesticides, and fertilizers on the Cape. So I think that's a significant accomplishment for the Cape. In particular, I want to thank the county commissioners and Sheila Lyons, who personally was in the room every time the negotiations between the Cape Cod Commission and NSTAR got to be a little thorny. So she was very good at facilitating that and producing a result. So we've got a lot of work in front of us on that. We're going to be working very closely with the county commissioners and other county departments to make sure that we've got a good plan moving forward. Additionally, we are making calls now to set up appointments with the boards of selectmen regionally, so we'll be notifying each one of you when we've made that appointment or prior to making that appointment in your town so that you can be available for those meetings. And then finally, I want to let you know that the Assembly of Delegates subcommittee voted to approve our new fee schedule, so that will move on to the full assembly on the 16th. And I appeared briefly in front of the Assembly of Delegates yesterday to let them know that we had passed the wind regs. The wind regs will be going to the county commissioners for their signature next Wednesday, so that it will appear in front of the Assembly of Delegates probably on the 16th, They can't take any action on the 16th, so we expect that the Assembly will be acting on those regs in April. And that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Director. Next on the agenda is to be a public hearing, which was continued from February 3rd, 2011, regarding the Red Jacket Resorts Development Agreement. Christie Sanatori, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. For the record, Christie Sanatori, Chief Regulatory Officer for the Commission. And again, this is the Red Jacket Resorts and the Davenport Company's Development Agreement that I'll be reviewing with you this afternoon. Just to give you an overview of what I'll be presenting, I'll first walk through the proposed project, a procedural overview. I'll walk you through the draft development agreement and the conclusions and recommendations that came out of the subcommittee. Just to give you a brief overview of the project, Red Jacket Resorts and the Davenport Companies, that's being represented by DeWitt Davenport, Managing Partner, and Paul Rummel, Chief Operating Officer, submitted a development agreement application to the Commission for the redevelopment of existing hotels along South Shore Drive in South Yarmouth. The development agreement is a two-party agreement between the applicant and the Cape Cod Commission. The Town of Yarmouth has provided much input and will review the project locally, but is not a participating party to the agreement. The project consists of 15.5 acres. There are currently four resorts on the site: the Red Jacket Beach, the Blue Water, the Edge of the Sea, and the Riviera Beach Resorts. There are various hotel buildings and cottages associated with these resorts. The project site is situated in Economic Center as designated on Yarmouth's Land Use Vision Map. And as defined in the Regional Policy Plan, economic centers are areas that are appropriate for growth and for redevelopment. The project site is also located in the Hotel Motel Overlay District 2, the zoning district in the town of Yarmouth. Just to walk you through briefly what the actual project will entail, it is the redevelopment of these project sites into two modern resorts. The first is the Red Jacket Beach Resort. This will be located at 1 South Shore Drive. It'll consist of a four-story seasonal hotel with 154 guest rooms and efficiency units. It'll also have cottages associated with it, parking and landscaping, an outdoor pool and deck, outdoor bar and grill area with seating, a hotel restaurant, and it will also include an on-site sewage treatment building and facility. The second resort is the Blue Water Resort, and this is also located on South Shore Drive. This will also be a new modern resort with three attached buildings, a four-story seasonal hotel, again, parking spaces and associated landscaping and other ancillary uses that are commonly associated with resort properties. Just to walk you briefly through a procedural overview, the project is governed by Chapter D, which are the Commission's Development Agreement Regulations. As you probably recall, on August 20th of 2009, the full commission considered the applicant's notice of intent to file a development agreement application with the commission, and the commission did approve this development notice of intent, and found that the proposed project was suitable and qualified to proceed for consideration as a development agreement with the Cape Cod Commission. The application was deemed complete in August of 2010, and there were several public hearings and public meetings before the subcommittee between November of 2010 and March of 2011, with the final public hearing being this afternoon on the proposal. There was a subcommittee meeting earlier this afternoon, and at this meeting, the subcommittee unanimously recommended that the full commission authorize the development agreement. And also at this meeting, DeWitt Davenport, on behalf of the applicant, signed the draft agreement, indicating his agreement to enter into the contract. To review with you in brief the standards of review and approval, this project has been reviewed pursuant to the 2009 Regional Policy Plan and also the Development Agreement Regulations. In accordance with Section 5E of the Development Agreement Regulations, the Commission must consider the project's consistency with the town's Local Comprehensive Plan, or LCP, local zoning and development bylaws, the Cape Cod Commission Act, and the Regional Policy Plan. Information that we have in the record provided by the Town of Yarmouth indicates that the proposed project is consistent with local zoning bylaws and with the goals of the local comprehensive plan. I will review the subcommittee's analysis of the project as memorialized in the draft decision that's before, a draft development agreement that's before you. And as you will see, the subcommittee did find that with appropriate relief granted and with appropriate conditions, that the project is consistent with both the Cape Cod Commission Act and the regional policy plan. Additionally, the Commission's development agreement regulations afford the applicant some flexibility through the development agreement. The regulations allow the subcommittee to recommend approval of an agreement that is consistent with the Act, the regional policy plan, or the local comprehensive plan if the inconsistency is necessary to enable a substantial segment of the population to secure adequate opportunities for housing, conservation, environmental protection, education, recreation, or balanced economic growth, and the interest protected by the Act, the regional policy plan, or the local comprehensive plan can be achieved or protected by an alternate approach, and this shall include appropriate mitigation. Section 5G of the Development Agreement Regulations state that a draft development agreement shall also contain a description of the public benefits and improvements which the qualified applicant has agreed to provide as consideration for the development agreement. And you'll see this outlined in the draft development agreement before you. On the list that's shown on the slide behind me are the benefits and improvements that the subcommittee found that the applicant has agreed to provide as consideration for the development agreement. The main benefit being provided as consideration of the agreement is the significant investment in capital by the development by the Davenport companies in this redevelopment project. The project also meets the regional policy plan best development practice land use 1.3, which encourages redevelopment in appropriate locations. This project is located in an economic center as mapped by the Town of Yarmouth on the land use vision map. And as I mentioned previously, economic centers are defined areas designated as appropriate for growth and redevelopment. The applicant has also gone above and beyond what the requirements of the regional policy plan are in the issue area of transportation, and they have committed to implementing a trip reduction plan for employees and guests of the resorts. The subcommittee further found that the project is appropriately located in the Town of Yarmouth's Motel Hotel Overlay 2 district, and that the proposed project will provide a significant community benefit, including higher, more stable wages, and the hotel and restaurant business will also collect a local option tax. The committee also identified that the reduction in nitrogen loading, the improved stormwater management, and the projected lower energy demand are benefits that the project is providing. Section 7 of the Development Agreement Regulations allows the agreement to be valid for 12 years and specifies that a development agreement may be adopted for longer than 12 years upon a two-thirds vote of the commission members present. The applicant has requested a 20-year development agreement. Due to the unknown time frame for construction and for securing financing for the project, and the subcommittee has unanimously recommended that the commission grant the 20-year agreement. As I previously mentioned, the project was reviewed pursuant to the 2009 Regional Policy Plan. I will provide for you in brief the issue areas and the subcommittee's analysis. I also would like to note that in your packets today, you have some minor revisions to the document. Specifically, you have revision to the language regarding assignment of the agreement. This was approved by the subcommittee this afternoon, and you also have an updated materials list and additional correspondence, and this is just from the past week since your mailing went out. So I'll briefly walk you through the issue areas, and I'll begin with land use. Minimum performance standard, or MPS LU 1.1, requires that development be consistent with this land use vision map category. And as I said before, this is situated in an economic center. It is consistent with the standard, and the remaining standards do not apply. In the issue area of economic development, Similar minimum performance standard, ED 1.1, requires development to be located in either economic centers, industrial service trade areas, or villages where appropriate. Again, the project is situated in economic center. It's consistent with this standard. And the remaining standards, again, in this section do not apply. With regard to water resources, the project is proposing wastewater treatment facilities at each resort, and the existing septic systems that are on the project site now will be removed. This is going to result in a 70% reduction in wastewater effluent nitrogen strength from approximately 35 to 10 parts per million of nitrogen. These facilities will require groundwater discharge permits from the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection. And the subcommittee has reviewed the project and conditioned the project, and require the development agreement is requiring staff review and approval of this groundwater discharge permit application to DEP in order to ensure that it also complies with the regional policy plan standards. There's also a condition in the agreement that requires compliance with stormwater standards. It appears, based on the project plans as proposed, that the project will conform to the standards. This is just a condition that would require staff analysis to make sure that it does comply. In the issue area of coastal resources, the proposed project may impact several coastal resources. However, the redevelopment at both sites will occur within previously altered areas that are associated with existing development. The beach decks that are proposed at both resorts are proposed in Coastal Bank. And in response to commission staff concerns from the outset, the applicant significantly reduced the size of the deck areas by over 2,000 square feet. The applicant has also proposed using removable panels for the decks so that dismantling prior to storms and during the off-season is available. And the decking proposed would also allow the sunlight to reach the dune grasses in the portions of the deck that are covering the dune. With these measures taken into consideration, the subcommittee did find and unanimously granted that the applicant was afforded flexibility in meeting the minimum performance standards. I just also briefly wanted to highlight some of the areas of compliance in the coastal resources section. You'll see the list of minimum performance standards behind me. The project does not interfere with coastal with public access to the shore. It does not impair the beneficial functions of the coastal resources. It substantially maintains views to the water. It's designed to accommodate relative sea level rise. It does not impede the landward migration of coastal resources. This is even with the construction of the decks. And it's not expected to significantly change overall site grades. And I also wanted to point out that they intend to install low impact designs, and this will be an improvement over the current conditions. With regard to natural resources, the Red Jacket site is located in a significant natural resource area, or SNRA, due to the designation of a barrier beach. Development at the Blue Water site is located outside of the coastal beach and outside of an SNRA. Due to the disturbed nature of both sites, the commission found that a natural resources inventory was not required. And as the proposed development is occurring within previously disturbed areas, the commission found that the permanent protection of open space was also not required. In the issue area of transportation, the project is not estimated to generate a significant amount of new traffic. The subcommittee found that there would not be a degradation in public safety. The site driveways comply with the level of service and site distance requirements, and also with the congestion management standards of the regional policy plan. The commission found that the project will not have a significant impact on the regional roadway system. And just to highlight again, the applicant has committed to implementing a trip reduction plan for the employees and guests of the facilities. And the subcommittee again found this to be a benefit of the project. Waste management standards require projects to be in compliance with the state's hazardous waste regulations. The applicant has acknowledged that the project may use, generate, treat, or store hazardous waste, construction and demolition waste, and solid waste and recyclables. And the subcommittee conditioned the development agreement to require that the applicant submit for staff review and approval information pertaining to the project's hazardous waste generator status, waste management plan, construction bid documents, and a solid waste recycling and management plan just to ensure that they will comply with the minimum performance standards. With regard to energy, the applicant has selected the 10% on-site renewable energy generation in order to comply with the RPP. The applicant has proposed a 52 kilowatt solar PV array to meet this 10% on-site requirement. The development agreement includes a condition requiring the applicant to dedicate required roof space in order to install this solar PV array, and also in order to comply with the regional policy plan. Okay. As a non-residential development project, only the standards under Affordable Housing Goal 3 apply. The affordable housing mitigation amount pursuant to the regional policy plan is approximately $92,000. The subcommittee took testimony from representatives of the town and the applicant and unanimously recommended that flexibility be afforded due to the town's efforts in affordable housing, including the recent Simpkins School project that provided over 65 units of senior rental affordable housing, over $3 million to the town's Affordable Housing Trust, and $1 million for the Housing Authority to be put towards the senior center, and additionally, the history of the applicant meeting housing needs. Just a couple more issue areas. In the issue area of community character, the proposed resorts are not located within a historic district, and there are no known historic resources on the project sites. Back in 2009, Massachusetts Historical Commission, or MHC, weighed in and determined that the proposed project site was unlikely to have a significant effect on historic or archaeological resources. This commission subcommittee has found that the project is consistent with the heritage preservation section of the regional policy plan. The structures are consistent with the town zoning requirements, and the applicant has incorporated the required variation in massing and facades and roof configuration, and the commission subcommittee found that the project design is consistent with the design guidelines and the architectural minimum performance standards of the RPP. With regard to landscaping, there are conditions in the development agreement that will require submission of final landscape plans and a landscape maintenance agreement for staff review and approval to ensure that consistency with the commission standards. And finally, there is the exterior lighting designs that have been submitted appear to be consistent with the commission's standards, and there's a condition in the agreement that would require staff review and approval of the final exterior lighting plans just to ensure consistency. Okay. In conclusion, again, just to reiterate that DeWitt Davenport, on behalf of the applicant, did sign the draft development agreement this afternoon, indicating his agreement to enter into the contract. There are two votes that you would need to take this afternoon. The first is pertaining to the length of the agreement. The subcommittee has unanimously recommended that the commission approve the request for the 20-year agreement. This needs a two-thirds vote of the commission members present today. And lastly, the commission subcommittee unanimously recommended that the full commission authorize the development agreement. I'm happy to answer any questions if you have any. We also have technical staff here available as well.
Do we have any questions of staff? Yes, Jordan.
I just didn't hear, and I couldn't find it in this pile of documents here. You indicated that there was a 70% reduction in the nitrogen wastewater discharge. What was it before, and what is it after?
It was. And I may refer to Tom Camberry, our water resources program manager, but there's a 70% reduction in nitrogen loading, to answer your question, and that was from 35 parts per million of nitrogen to 10 parts per million of nitrogen.
Okay, that's all I need.
Good. Okay.
Next will be the applicant.
I Good afternoon, everyone. My name is DeWitt Davenport, and I'm the general partner for the Red Jacket Resorts that are of discussion in front of you today. I'm not going to talk about the redevelopment plans or any of the technical components unless a question is asked. Paul Rummel's going to go through a PowerPoint presentation giving you a brief overview on the history of the project and where we are today. I'm going to talk about two things. First is a special thank you to Christy for doing such an outstanding job of moving the project forward through the entire commission. The second one is I want to talk about you, the folks on the other side of the wall. I want to thank you for the time that you're giving the county. You could be out for a beautiful walk on the beach today, but you're here working hard so that we can have a better place to live, to work, and to play. I talked about that briefly with the subcommittee when we first started the process over at the Yarmouth Police Station, and I felt it's necessary to repeat it again today, and I thank the subcommittee for working with us so diligently through this entire process. Again, thank you for your time. It's the most valuable resource that you have, and we appreciate everything you've done.
We have just a brief presentation, understanding that you have a full packet in front of you with plans and the narrative and everything else, but we'll just kind of roll through it fairly quickly here. This slide here we've used in different presentations is more of a placeholder, but it really does give you a good idea about the project. The upper project here, this is an existing Red Jacket Beach location. Those of you who haven't been by there, it's if you were high above Nantucket Sound looking at the property. And this other one here, just to give you an idea, is the blue water edge of the sea in the Riviera Beach down here. So when we started this project, we had a simple goal, and this is it here, to design the modern resort hotel with an equal amount of guest rooms. That's key, equal amount of guest rooms, no increase in the number of rooms. Restaurant, conference rooms, indoor pool, outdoor pool, the spa, the sitting areas, and all the necessary amenities needed to accommodate today's travelers. And to do so within all the parameters of all the different zoning and requirements from the town, the county, the state, and federal organizations. And that was our goal at the beginning, and we've been right on track, and that's our goal still today. So why would we want to do this? And why are we going through all this effort? And you realize we're requesting a 20-year agreement. Well, first, to recover from a horrific natural disaster, such a hurricane, recover from a catastrophic loss, such as a fire. Really key is to meet the needs of today's family vacationer. These properties were built a while ago. They're beautiful, but the rooms are smaller. We need more space for business centers and things like that. So we're going to meet the needs of today's traveling public, basically, and really to position the business when there's a market correction to be able to move forward. Christy mentioned the HMOD2. This was put into place a few years ago. Actually, it was 3 years ago at Yarmouth Town Meeting. This zoning district was overwhelmingly approved, and it's very well written. The goals and purposes of the HMOD2, which is the Hotel Motel Overlay District 2. South Shore Drive is a traditional seaside motel area located in residential zoning district. It's the intent of this bylaw to provide South Shore Drive motel owners with the ability to renovate, reconstruct, and or replace properties by right. And by doing so, to try and tie it into the neighborhood, there was an awful lot of emphasis placed on the community character portion of this, which I'll talk about in just a minute. This is the economic impact from the site as it exists today. This is last year, actually. This is combined with the Red Jacket, the Edge of the Sea, the Riviera Beach, and Blue Water. The 6% local option tax, this local option tax, is $580,000. That's a significant sum to the town of Yarmouth. And personal and property taxes are $200,000. roughly 300 employees and payroll dollars, about $3 million plus gratuities. That's substantial for the town. So there's two slides. This one is to what happens when we redevelop, and what happens if we don't is the next one. Basically, we want to stabilize and increase revenue to the tax base, update and modernize to meet today's existing and changing needs, the consumers. The property values will increase. We'll increase the real estate taxes to the town, and an increase in the average room rate will add more tax revenue for the town. It's pretty simple. We go in there? There we go. And if this is the other side, if we don't do anything. So what's so critical about this project and this redevelopment is that we're planning for the future, and we're in good shape now, but what happens if we don't do anything? Properties get more and more outdated. Other areas of competition, the Cape's not just, we're not just competing with who's on Cape Cod, we're competing with other regions. It's very important to the Cape to stay up on all this. Well, over time, the 6% local option tax would decline. Real estate and property taxes will decline. The number of employees and payroll dollars, the number of people we can keep working with the good jobs, unfortunately, will decline down the road. With the town of Yarmouth, we have had this has been a great process with the town of Yarmouth. We're in our fourth year. It's actually over 4 years of working on this, between trying to organize for the zoning district. Just even the going out and looking for folks that could handle these kind of plans and engineers and things like that. So we're in our fourth, well into our fourth year. Again, the creation of the motel overlay district was 3 years ago at town meeting, passed overwhelmingly. We had to go back the next year for a little tweak. That also passed overwhelmingly at town meeting. But really, we've had tremendous cooperative effort with town officials, with everybody listed here, and outstanding feedback. This has been really a case for the town of Yarmouth of everyone rowing in the same direction, trying to have a common goal. We say a lot, begin with the end in mind. Try and get your arms around a redevelopment project of this size. You got to have a vision for it and then get there, just trying to overcome all the hurdles. It's been a cooperative effort. We've had outstanding feedback. The CEDC, the Yarmouth Chamber of Commerce, and various committees within that group. The town selectmen have been super to us, officials, staff, Karen Green, Terry Silvio in Planning and Community Development, Design Review Committee, the Planning Board, formal design review we've been through with the town through the HMOD2 district requires that, and we've had public hearings, we've been through informal site plan review, we'll go back for formal site plan review when we're ready to move forward, and we've also had the support of police and fire. It was not just even for this redevelopment project, but even before this, going back a couple of years for this version of the RPP that was adopted in 2009, a lot of Yarmouth officials, including us and a lot of you folks, we all saw you at all those meetings and a lot of nights out of the house, but it was great to have an impact. We felt like the town of Yarmouth, we really had an impact on the regional policy plan, and that it was great. So it's been a wonderful relationship working on that. There we go. This here, like sort of the, almost like the first slide I showed you, this is Red Jacket Beach, and it's an overhead view of Red Jacket Beach. The property line pretty much goes just about like this around here. Nantucket Sound out here, Parker's River here, just so you can get your bearings a little bit. It's kind of a spread out building right now. It's, you know, the newer building will actually have a smaller footprint than this one here. At Red Jacket Beach, for this particular property, we have Concept A and Concept B, and we kind of detailed that in the application and in the narrative. Concept A is our preferred layout. Really, it has to do with the right-of-way. If those folks with rights of way over the property, if we can get them all to agree, and we've been working towards that, to relocate the right-of-way, we will do so. So Concept A assumes that we will be able to relocate the right-of-way, which means there's a drive coming in just like this to the hotel. This is the hotel right here, kind of a Y shape, which will afford great views of Parker's River and Nantucket Sound, et cetera. Get a little bit of a winding boulevard look coming through. Also, we got this on. These are a couple of the cottages that Christy referred to in her presentation, and a septic treatment facility right here. Outdoor pool, parking, tree-lined, kind of a boulevard look coming in. The existing right-of-way, which I'll show you on another slide in a minute, but basically it comes right through here, right through this way. So if everybody agrees, and we're hoping that's the case, we'll be able to relocate the right-of-way over to the end of the property and landscape it nice for them, and it'd be a great situation. But we're prepared either way. Concept B. This is the site plan for Concept B. Instead of the boulevard entrance coming this way, you can see there's a right-of-way right through here, tree-lined right-of-way for folks, and that will become the main entrance. We prefer A, but this is, we're prepared to go with this. Really, there's very little changes other than the rerouting of the drive on these plans. Nothing changes on the where the main hotel sits on the property. There are slight movements in the septic treatment plant and a couple of the cottages, but nothing too much. So we're prepared either way. Come on, there it is. Show you a few of the elevations. So again, you have some of these in your packet, but this is the Red Jacket Beach property. If you were coming down South Shore Drive and up high, maybe a seagull's view coming down the road. Again, here's our winding boulevard. The main hotel right here, in the Y-shaped configuration. Pork share right here for people when they check in, etc. The two cottages down lower here. Septic treatment plant right here. Again, you've got Nantucket Sound out this way and Parker's River over in here. This is another view of Red Jacket Beach, and this one here gives you an idea on the roof. The space, as Christy mentioned, we're going to produce at least 10% of our own electricity on site through solar PV arrays on the roof. We'll also have some equipment up there, but that's why there's a lot of roof space, and it's going to be perfect for producing a good portion of our own energy. This is one of our favorite shots. This is a night shot. Amazing what they can do these days. And this gives you an idea at night, the lighting, and I'll point it out later too, but there's different balconies and posts, and we've done some different treatments on some of the balconies to break up the building a little bit. Should mention too that when I mentioned the cooperative effort with the town, also with the commission, the community character portion of this, which was big to put a, get these buildings so that everybody was happy with the design, and everybody was happy with the design in the end, and it was a great time. We had the Yarmouth Planning Board, we had Yarmouth Design Review, we had Cape Cod Commission, we had everybody in the room at the same time for several meetings, and also some communications electronically. But in the end, there was a lot of input. These plans changed quite a bit over time with all of that input, a lot of good input along the way. This gives you a little bit of a look at the two cottage buildings. A lot of what we did in the community character portion of this is there's different roof pitches and broken up, the roofs are broken up. Some of the longer portions of the building, I might show you better on the blue water, but angles and turns in the building, so it's not one big long line. There's some different railings and balcony separations, different window treatments in different parts of the building. Tried to really break up what they call the mass. Again, that's just another image of the cottages. Another one. Again, you can see here some of the different architecture with some of the separations of the balconies, window treatments, roof lines, a lot of character there. Our goal was to make it look like a turn of the century, I guess the last century, resort. Again, just the level if you were coming down the drive to check in. Okay, now we switch over to the blue water, edge of the sea in the Riviera Beach. This is a overhead Google Earth shot here. Blue water resort right here, edge of the sea, and Riviera Beach. So all three of these properties, the intention is to combine them into one. And this is the site plan for that. The Nantucket Sound out here, and to the right here, Nantucket Sound, and this is South Shore Drive, coming down South Shore Drive right here. And again, you can see the building is broken up, different angles. Also, it steps down on the ends. A lot of good suggestions that came out of the community character meetings. Tree-lined. We've still maintained the right-of-way through this property, right through here, and I'll show you in a minute how that goes right through the building, actually. And again, we're working with the neighbors here. Hopefully, we'll get that going again. And if we come to some agreement to relocate a right-of-way, we need them all to agree to that. But the right-of-way would be done this side of the property. So this is the blue water location again, and you can see again, it's in here. We got some glass on some of the balconies. A lot of different pitches on the roof. I mentioned before it steps down at the ends. A lot of detail, a lot of different architectural detail, balusters, glass, mix it up a little bit. It's an overhead shot, and again, you get the right-of-way coming off of South Shore Drive right here. It goes underneath one of the little pass-throughs here so that folks can get right to use their right-of-way. And same thing here on the roof spaces, a lot of room for the solar PV panels. You're going to be checking in. This is what you'll be looking at coming up the drive. Now, that's it for the elevations for the most part, but this is something we feel very good about, is that this project is really an example of the type of redevelopment that's the goal of the Yarmouth Land Use Vision Map and the Regional Policy Plan, with all the economic centers. They direct growth, and in our case, the redevelopment to the economic centers where it's desired. Many of these tools, as you know, you worked on the RPP, were put into place. We feel like this is the perfect fit, this project, and that a lot of what we've done, we've worked together on, really falls into what everybody was trying to do with the land use vision maps, et cetera, and the economic centers. That's it for me. Do it.
Paul did a great job of complimenting Christie's presentation, but what he didn't say is that we've been some pretty tough customers to deal with. We won't be, Paul and I personally, as well as our entire team, want to thank the staff for their patience and indulgence. We're not attorneys, we're not permitting authorities, or specialists, I should say. We're people that run a business, and the business happens to be the hospitality industry. We've had to work with all the parts, and working with everything from FEMA regulations to the state DEP, understanding coastal resources to town of Yarmouth, everything from Conservation Commission to the Planning Board to the Selectmen, to make sure we get it right. It took a lot of time. Unfortunately, we stubbed our toes a couple of times, but it was all with the right intention. Paul talked about you start with the end in mind, and that's why he started with the goal. It's been a little bit of a lumpy road because we have been very concerned throughout the process for what we refer to as unintended consequences. We didn't want to have the bowl of jelly where you push it down, or jello, when you push it down in one area and it pops up in the other. We've been very diligent in trying to make sure that we've covered all the bases so that everybody through the process is satisfied at the end that the outcome is what they believe is in the best interest of the Cape, and for our side of it, the best interest of our guests and our staff serving our guests. So to the folks at the commission who had to deal with us, we just want to say thank you. And again, Christie, a special thank you for keeping us on track. With that, we'd be happy to answer any questions you have, and I do know some folks in the audience would like to speak. I'm not sure what your pleasure is, Mr. Chairman, but we'll follow your lead.
First, I would ask if there are any questions from the commission, and then we'll go on to the public comment period. Are there any questions? Seeing none, we'll ask for comments from federal, state, and local officials. Federal officials, anybody? State officials? Local officials, please come forward. Thank you.
Good afternoon, Suzanne McAuliffe, Yarmouth Board of Selectmen. We have with us today, and I don't believe all are speaking, four members of our Board of Selectmen, and throughout the hearings, we have had all five of us in attendance at the subcommittee hearings at various times. I would like to reiterate what Dewitt Davenport said in terms of thanking the commission's staff and the commission subcommittee for working with us. Everyone knows Yarmouth raises a fuss at times, and people have been very patient with hearing our concerns, letting us submit extra testimony, letting us make extra presentations, letting us try and document what it is that we wanted changed in your regulations, and people have been very considerate and kind and heard us, and the best outcome is I think that there was very little, if anything, that we can think of that the commission didn't help us with and agree with, and so for us it's been a very positive outcome for the working with the commission on this. Just a brief overstatement, as you can tell from the economics of this, this is an economic project that's key to the future of the town of Yarmouth. $80 million is the redevelopment figure that's thrown out there. That may be conservative, because if this is over a 10, 20-year project, it could be even bigger than that. So we have the ongoing revenue aspect, but we also have the linchpin to economic development in Yarmouth. We have several other projects in Yarmouth that are in the pipeline, and people are watching how this project comes forward. This is going to be the example that will give other developers or other residents or other business owners the idea that, well, yes, I can go ahead, or no, I won't, because it's not doable. This project has demonstrated that it's doable, and we really are very grateful for that. In terms of a couple of issues, we are specifically grateful for the consideration on the affordable housing issue. Yarmouth has worked very hard over the last 4 or 5 years through town meeting votes to pump over $3 million into our affordable housing. We have a project of 65 units, and in addition, that $1 million that was mentioned is not going to the senior center. It's going to senior housing and mixed-use affordable housing that the Housing Authority is working on. So we've really gone out of our way to accommodate affordable housing and appreciate the consideration on that in terms of waiving the mitigation, and we are grateful for that. And lastly, I can't say enough about the Davenport Company in terms of being residents of the town of Yarmouth, being a philanthropic business in the town of Yarmouth. Not only do they provide good jobs, but they are very involved in their generosity in terms of providing for charitable organizations, for charitable donations. They have a lot of affordable units that we will be utilizing if our motels end up closing through the Affordable Housing Trust to put people into affordable housing. They run a big fundraiser every year that gives directly not only to the Yarmouth community, but also to the Cape Cod community as well. So it's very nice to have such an outstanding business and resident and citizenship in Yarmouth afforded this opportunity to stay in Yarmouth and to show other developers that, yes, you can do this. So thank you to the commissioners who worked so hard on this. I know sometimes it was a bit of a tug of war. And thank you to Mr. Nedzwicki for helping shepherd us through some of the ups and downs of this. And particularly thank you to the staff, because I know they have a lot of expertise that we needed to hear, but they were willing to listen to us too. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public officials? Yes.
My name is Peter Smith. I'm the chairman of the town of Yarmouth's Community and Economic Development Council. And the council has unanimously voted and enthusiastically support the redevelopment efforts proposed by the Red Zacket Resorts and their lodging facilities along South Shore Drive. Over the past few years, the town of Yarmouth has focused, and its residents have overwhelmingly voted at town meeting to strengthen the tourist industry. The town has put a great deal of effort into recreating zoning and design standards that will incentivize the development of modern lodging facilities along the town's waterfront. plans for the redevelopment of the Red Jacket Resorts represent the culmination of these efforts. This project, the biggest redevelopment project in Yarmouth history, will draw visitors to the town and to the Cape, and as such will all benefit locally and regionally. We hope you will have strong support as the people in the town of Yarmouth. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other public officials? Yes, please.
Good afternoon. Nanette Davidson. I'm the president of the Yarmouth Area Chamber of Commerce, and I'm here to read a letter that was approved by our board in support of the Davenport. Cape Cod is an iconic brand, built from decades of family vacation memories. For 40 years, one town on Cape Cod has been the leader in bringing families to the area for their beach vacations. Yarmouth has been the number one destination in Massachusetts for beach vacations over this period. This is measured in based on lodging revenue and room nights sold. In an effort to continue the competitive vacation destination, the Yarmouth Chamber, in partnership with the town of Yarmouth, has engaged in a strategic plan to position our community for the next 25 years. The plan is multi-pronged, and its key components include public and private infrastructure improvements, wastewater systems, traffic management enhancements, gateway improvements, creation of a dedicated revenue stream for destination marketing, zoning, and regulatory relief to encourage the expedited rebuilding of our lodging stock. The cornerstone of Yarmouth's redevelopment strategy is the enhancing of our lodging stock. Today's vacation families want more from their lodging facilities. Family suites, larger rooms, spas, conference centers, holiday space, hospitality space, exercise rooms, cafes, restaurants, and the children's entertainment areas are now considered common as a competitive lodging facility. With all but one of our lodging facilities over 25 years old and many over 40, Yarmouth is ready for reinvestment to meet the demands of today's and tomorrow's travelers. This is why the Yarmouth Chamber and the entire business community is excited about the proposed redevelopment of our four Red Jacket facilities. The plan in particular for the Red Jacket Beach Resort are reminiscent of the grand old hotels that dotted the New England landscape many decades ago. The benefits of these two projects do not just surround the building's aesthetics and site design. The new facilities will make the property significantly more energy efficient, better equipped to handle hurricane damage, better equipped to treat wastewater, better equipped to handle stormwater, and significantly enhanced for fire safety. All of these benefits accrue to the community as a whole, in addition to the property owners. Economically, the government and the town has a lot at stake with these two projects. A significant portion of the town's room tax revenue is generated by these resorts. These resorts also employ dozens of our neighbors who will enjoy growing wages and lengthening the employment season. We all know several local property owners are eager to see this type of reinvestment as a catalyst for their own property improvements. The creation of signature resorts will allow Yarmouth to remain competitive with surrounding communities. They are a perfect fit to our community's desire to remain a healthy vacation destination. We are grateful that a locally owned company is willing to further demonstrate its commitment to improving our environment and our economy with a redevelopment project of this scale. We encourage the Cape Cod Commission to approve and endorse the development agreement. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there any other public officials? Any comments from the public? Seeing none, any questions from the commission members? I see none. I would entertain a motion to close the hearing on the record if somebody is so inclined. It's been moved, it's seconded. All in favor will signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? It's a unanimous vote, and thank you very much. The next thing we would have to do as we move along is to adopt the development agreement proposal for 20 years. And I'll ask the vice chairman if he would be kind enough to make that motion.
I move to adopt the development agreement for the proposed 20 years.
Moved and seconded. Is there any discussion on this matter? All right. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Another unanimous vote. Thank you. The next motion would be to move to authorize the development agreement with the Davenport Company and the Cape Cod Commission. And if the Vice Chairman would be kind enough to do that.
I move to authorize the development agreement with the Davenport Companies and the Cape Cod Commission for the proposed redevelopment on South Shore Drive in South Yarmouth.
Been moved and seconded. Is there any discussion? I don't see any. And all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? And it's another unanimous vote. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, Davenport Companies. Thank you, Commission staff, who have done remarkably, as they always do for us. The leadership of Christie and company. You're welcome. Thinking about our transportation manager, he's always up and ready to go.
Yeah, I am ready to go, Mr.
And I understand that the regional transportation plan is going to be put off to another time?
Correct. We are not ready to present that today. We're waiting for some financial data from the state before we can complete that plan and bring it back to it at another meeting.
Good.
So with that, I would like to move forward.
We'll look forward to that.
Regional transportation plan. That's the one we're putting over. That's all right. We will be talking about bike planning on Cape Cod. That plan is ready to go. We've had quite a few recent efforts. Let me just begin with Glenn Cannon. I'm the Director of Technical Services for the Cape Cod Commission, and I would like to go over our recent bike planning efforts that we've had on Cape Cod over the past year or so here. Some of the plans that we have had is the Cape Cod, or our overall bike plan. We've really been trying to focus more on a regional nature. You'll see we have we've had discussions with regional connections to our neighboring RTAs, regional transportation authorities also. We also had a significant project brought forward with the National Seashore. We call it the Top 40 Projects. I believe there were actually 48 projects in that plan, though. I'll briefly touch on those. Some of the connections we've had, what we're finding as we go out to the different towns, the towns are very supportive, and they're looking for us to make connections to existing bike facilities to their downtown areas. This is something that we want to promote, and we want to help these towns assist them with, because we're looking to bring that economic development component to it, and also to give people destinations for where they're heading. This is our overall, the existing conditions and proposed conditions, and it's very tough. This is the Cape Cod Canal bike path right here, though, the existing rail trail in Falmouth. This is a section of Route 28 in Barnstable. You can see there are intermittent multi-use paths here, or bike paths, throughout Cape Cod. The Cape Cod rail trail leading all the way up. There are existing bike paths up in Provincetown and in Truro. There is a section in Yarmouth here that has been completed. And then this section right along here is currently programmed. There is money, and it is under design right now. Hopefully, I believe it's a 2013 date for construction there. And again, the Chatham Spur here.
What we're looking to do as a regional planning agency is we're looking to make the connections in the gaps that exist currently in the existing path that you see. Again, we have the Canal area bike path right here. We have the Falmouth Rail Trail, but we have no connection between the two, so we'd like to facilitate that connection. We're looking for the connections outside of our region. We have a connection here in Barnstable. Approximately here is Yarmouth Road right here, where the extension of the Cape Cod Rail Trail will come right there, so we're looking for this connection also. We're looking for a southern route connecting Falmouth to Barnstable also. On this plan right here is Route 130 in Mashpee. The town of Mashpee has done a very good job of bringing a bike path up along Route 130. We're probably looking to complete that connection also. Again, the end of the Cape Cod Rail Trail here in Wellfleet, looking for the connection all the way up to Provincetown, and then a connection across from Chatham to Orleans. Again, we've been working with the agencies to our north here, the Southeast Regional Planning and Economic Development link in Wareham. They have a preferred alternative to bring that link up to Buzzards Bay on 6 and 28 at the Bill Dalton Bridge. So we need to talk and make sure we have our discussions with the town of Bourne to make sure we're ready for that connection when it comes forward, to bring that connection to the Cape Cod bike path right here, the canal bike path. That connection, they hope, will stretch, I believe it is as far as Swansea right now, going out to the west. And then the Old Colony Planning Council and a link up into Plymouth. I have a meeting with them next Tuesday to help to discuss our coordination in that area and making sure that we have a connection going to the north, just to make sure we're ready for them when they're ready, to make sure that our planning efforts are also coordinated to make sure we meet up at the desired locations. This is the National Seashore, like I say, the top 40 projects, a very comprehensive study conducted with the National Park Service and Cape Cod Commission staff. They're really looking to, like I say, they have the overall approach. They're trying to integrate bike planning efforts with the existing bicycle network and trying to connect to downtown areas. We see that as a critical component, just to make sure that people have a destination to where they want to go to. We constantly hear discussions on Cape Cod about car-free vacations also, where people are coming into their downtown areas, they're staying at a hotel or at their vacation home, they're leaving their car at home and they're spending the day on their bicycle. To do this, you know, they need to be able to get to facilities and to amenities that they need during the day. So we're looking to make those connections. Again, a lot of the focus of the study, I'd say, is more towards the out of Cape, where the National Seashore has they have more influence over what goes on out there. They have a greater desire to see connections into their own national park. You know, we understand that. So we are looking to pick up a little bit more of the Upper Cape, I would say, from this study than maybe was put into this effort. Some of the things that were outlined in that plan, though, again, they do have a connection here connecting Bourne to Falmouth. That's a bike path right here. This right here, they show it as a bike route, and the difference being there's a bike path is a separate facility from the roadway, probably a little bit easier for your families and your children, where the bike route is an on-road facility. These are generally your more dedicated bikers. We see everything down here on Cape Codville. You see the race teams. You see very people who don't even want to be on a path. They prefer to be on the roadway. They're very serious about it. They're very high speed. So you have to accommodate both within your plan. Again, as we move forward with the Cape Cod Commission with our efforts, we're really looking to make this connection, this regional connection right here. The plan addressed it in the the top 40 projects, but we need a more defined preferred route before we can move out and look for funding of that. Again, out on the Outer Cape, they are also looking to extend the Cape Cod Rail Trail. They're very active in this. I know the National Seashore is pursuing a couple grant opportunities to see if they can move this along and facilitate design money for that. Again, they also have a southern route here along Route 28. That again is an on-road facility. Really what you're looking to do is to, doing an assessment of the existing conditions and more of an enhancement as to what they have today. Some sections of Route 28 have adequate shoulder for biking and some sections just don't. So we're really looking to upgrade those facilities. This is a recent effort that the Cape Cod Commission undertook. It is the Yarmouth Road Corridor. This is exit 7 here off of Route 6. This is Willow Street in Yarmouth, existing four-lane cross-section here. This is the regional, the Hyannis Transportation Center down here, where they have an existing bike path along here. This is the existing bike path in Yarmouth, and then this is a program connection right here. Again, bringing that down to Willow Street. We're trying to make the connection down to the Hyannis Transportation Center and downtown Hyannis, even so far down as to the Steamship Authority. We were successful coming up with a preferred alternative for Yarmouth Road. That preferred alternative had a pedestrian component to it and a multi-use component to it. This is the Yarmouth Road preferred alternative looking south. As you're heading down from exit 7, the airport would be on your right-hand side. There was a lot of discussion about the placement of that multi-use path as to which side of the roadway it would go on. The thought being, there were kind of really two schools of thought. One being that they didn't really want it next to airport property. Their feeling was that that had a little bit too much of an industrial feel to it. Going to the other side of the roadway, though, they felt that there were too many driveways along that section of roadway and too many impediments to safe biking. So ultimately, the task force decided on the west side of the road next to the airport. We do believe with landscaping, and there is some landscaping between the Yarmouth Road right away and the airport, they haven't built up to the property line, that it won't have that industrial feel that the task force was concerned about. Another recent effort that we've undertaken here is the Harwich Bike Ped Plan. It is a connection of Harwich Center down to Harwich Port and connecting the beaches. Again, a community that's looking for that connection from the Cape Cod Rail Trail. It is actually the Chatham Spur to connect it along their own roadways within town down to Route 28 in Harwich Port. So people will get off the rail trail to have a place to stop. They can visit and then go back on their way with a safe route. A little bit different. This is the Chatham Spur right here, Cape Cod Rail Trail, Harwich Center. This is Bank Street, and that was chosen as the preferred alternative for the connection. So you come right along the Chatham Spur here. You're already at downtown Harwich. Bank Street has an existing sidewalk along it. What the town's really looking to do is to upgrade that to make it so it's it can accommodate pedestrians and bicyclists. Right now, it has a sidewalk that goes from being separated from the roadway to actually being right on the roadway. And unfortunately, the section that's on the roadway is on the inside of a curve where you can see the cars, they cut the corner. So as a pedestrian, you certainly don't feel safe in that environment. There's also a connection here on Earl Street to connect down to the beach from Lower County Road. A desire from the town, this was the second project they want to move forward with. This is sidewalks along Route 28. We've also heard from the town of Harwich, and we've put in for a request from the State Highway Department for sidewalks along the entire section of Route 28 within Harwich. We haven't followed up on those discussions with the state right now. They're still pending, so we need to have that discussion with them about, the length of Route 28. There are current sidewalks, particularly in Harwich Port on Route 28, and there are gaps that need to be filled in is what it really comes down to. Again, there are sections that have adequate sidewalk. Two or three years ago, they had a program where they actually put in new sidewalks along here, so they're in pretty good shape, but there are some gaps that need to be filled. Another project the town was looking at, this is Gorham Road right here, the harbor right here, Sacquatucket. They want to make that connection from the rail trail down to the harbor. This would be an on-road facility. It's a very low volume travel by automobile, so we did feel it was appropriate to have bicyclists in the road here. And then this is a connection that, one potential connection, I should say, along Thompson Field. That would need some further investigation by the town as to whether or not they want to actually move forward with that. There was also Water Department land in this area right here for that connection. We did do a preliminary investigation of that right there with the head of the Water Department, very gracious for us. But we feel that he was looking for a 200-foot separation between any paved surface and his town wells here, and we were not able to achieve that. So that one, it would take further investigation, looking at the properties beside it. There was some discrepancy of ownership within the property up in this area right here, so that's something that would have to be resolved. A little bit beyond our capability, I think, resolving the ownership issue. And this is in the town of Sandwich. Again, the town is looking for a connection between the Cape Cod bike path up here, and this is Army Corps land, coming down to downtown Sandwich. And then as we furthered those discussions and we talked to them about, you know, where they want to see downtown, it was my opinion, I thought we were talking about the town hall area. They were also interested in Route 6A Jarvis Street here, which has more of a commercial feel to it. Jarvis Street has quite a few businesses along it. So we're looking at connections to both of these areas. One of the things, again, that I think all the towns are really looking for, if we can, they want a connection here into Merchant Square. That's opposite the Stop and Shop Plaza over here. If we can make that connection through Merchant Square or adjacent to it, again, travelers have the opportunity to stop in there, rest, get their drinks, move on, do a little bit of shopping if you could, even on your bicycle, as long as it isn't too long of a ride, and then move along. One of the reasons why we're happy to assist with this in our overall plan to get to the Cape Cod Canal here, the Route 130 in Sandwich is a critical component. So this link here, we're happy to work with the town on this one. It's a little bit smaller scale project maybe than what we're really looking at, but it is a critical link. And that's one of the things I think you always see with all pedestrian or bicycle facilities. You don't always see the link that you're looking for. A couple of the alternatives, again, we have multiple alternatives here that we still need to discuss with the town. This is coming off the Cape Cod Canal here. This is Freezer Road. One possibility is coming along Tupper Road. There are multiple options going through Merchant Square. This is a detail of what could be done in Merchant Square. Commission staff is having a meeting with the merchants in Merchant Square on Friday morning. This is another alternative right here coming through town land, again with the water department land. This is Route 6A, so that's a discussion we'd have to have along with the town. Again, coming along Tupper Road. One of the things that we've talked about is whether or not the plan to get to the canal, we come down and connect both the areas that the town's looking at. This is the town hall area here, Daniel Webster Inn, coming up along Jarvis Street here, coming back to Route 6A, and completing a loop. I think you never really want to dump any travelers out, you know, just at an endpoint. So if we can create the loop, they can get back up here, come back to where they originally came from. There's also been brought forward from the town a boardwalk idea here behind Route 6A. I can't recall right now the name of the marsh right here, but this is a boardwalk plan that a private resident from the town of Sandwich is actually bringing forward to see if he can get funding for that. We are going to incorporate his design into our plan so it can be brought in. He'll have connections again along Jarvis Street here, up in Route 6A, and then Route 6A again. We're not incorporating his plan into our plan. I'll tell you that I can say that though. I think this is a longer term plan right here. He'll have to go through significant environmental reviews for this. The town is looking for something that could be done a little quicker than that, something that probably a little bit cheaper than this also. Once you get into boardwalks and environmental permitting, the cost can increase significantly. So again, we're going to incorporate, you know, we're going to make sure we accommodate for that plan. We're not going to incorporate it, I should say. But those are our planning efforts for now. We do have future events coming up. Cape Cod Bike Week is coming up in May, and then we have Alternative Transportation Week. So I'd be happy to answer any questions that you have. And if you don't have any questions,
yes,
you will probably see us coming to your town soon.
Yes, just a minute, please. Okay, I'm going to start with Mary Pat because I know she has to leave.
Well, thank you very much, Roy. My question is on that previous slide of the canal to downtown Sandwich. Where on that map is the so-called Golden Triangle that they're planning to develop?
Much further south.
Oh, much further
south. Much south of Route 6. Again, as we get into this plan, the connection of going along Route 130 would be a critical component getting down to the Golden Triangle and that connection there. And we are, you know, we're really trying to focus on the more the regional structure, almost the spine of Cape Cod we're trying to follow, but those connections from north to south and east to west, we're also trying to make those connections also. We need to have further discussions with the town of Sandwich, but like I say, Mashpee is coming north on Route 130 to make that connection as a natural connection.
Thank you. Ernie?
Go ahead. A couple of questions.
Sure.
The Bass River Railroad Bridge is gone. Thank God. How many times I hit that? Anyway, where and when will you be able, will anybody get funding? Is that the precise area they're going to try and go down that railroad line? Is there plans for a bridge over for some?
No, there are no plans in that area at this time. Let me just see if I. Because
you've mentioned the area.
Yeah,
I mean, the train path there.
The only connection right now, Ernie, in that general area is south of Route 6 right here, where they're really going to extend the existing Cape Cod Rail Trail to Yarmouth Road. So that's the connection now.
So that really taking the bridge out has nothing to do with.
No, not with the rail planning. As a matter of fact, one of the again, we're talking about these links that are broken here. One of the things that we're trying to overcome right now is to get a bridge going over Willow Street, Yarmouth Road right now. It was actually taken out of their plan due to the cost. So, you know, we have this existing Cape Cod Rail Trail right here coming up to Yarmouth Road. It's meeting at an at-grade traffic signal. You know, we have a plan to bring it south. We have a plan to bring it west. But, you know, I think when you're talking about families and children, you know, there's an expectation that you have separation from the road and a degree of safety. So, you know, this is one of the critical links that we're probably trying to make. So, you want to truth? I'll tell you right now, Andy. Any option would be on the table. So we may take a look at it.
Well, I mean, we're talking about you just mentioned any safety between families, you know, for families. And, you know, okay, we're talking about bicycle paths, but boating is a big thing. And, you know, it's pretty unsafe. They put that darn bridge back there.
Yeah.
But I mean, you know, it's just, it was something I didn't know that I thought.
Well, I think as we walk into any community, you know, we always try to walk in with a blank slate and to listen to the community and hear what they have to say and what ideas they have. So that'll be something that we could, you know, we can discuss. How far it goes, I'm not sure, but I mean, we can certainly have the discussions.
Yeah, everything's there. You only need a bridge.
Yeah, that's,
you
know what I
mean?
Well.
You don't have to build it. The other thing is, on that high-speed type bicycling, right, is that regulated in any way, or can they just go anywhere they want?
No, they have just, I want to say, beefed up the laws right now for bicycling, where bicyclists are treated as motorists and need to respect the rules of the road. So there are rules in place now, and soon to be enforced. I know they haven't really stepped it up, but generally, when the new regulations come out, they prep the local police who pass out a few tickets just so you remember you should be following the rules of the road. So you be careful if you're one of those, which I am, just so you know.
Are there any other questions or comments? Joy. Next, after Joy.
As we encourage more and more people to use the bike path, I think they've gotten the message, because last summer on the Lower Cape, you couldn't use the bike path if you were a year-rounder, because more and more families were biking their vacations. Is there any thought to widening the bike path again and putting pedestrian walkways along the outer edges of the bike path? Because now with rollerbladers, kids on bikes with training wheels, people three abreast talking, the people racing through that think they're in the Grand Prix, and the casual bikers, it's impossible.
Yeah, from my own experience, the last time I was at the rail trail in Falmouth, you could not bicycle on the rail trail. There were so many pedestrians along there. So we haven't had those discussions yet, but that's a great point and something we'll have to look at. You know, it's interesting when you're talking about bike paths, we're talking about capacity issues. And if you're over capacity, then you need to make some adjustments to that.
Thank you. Any other, well, Peter Munger, yes, that's right. And then Elizabeth.
There's a local movement in Orleans to have an extension of a bike trail from where the bike trail crosses Main Street down to Norton Beach. Are you familiar with that? Is that something you're working on?
I am not. The town of Orleans is very active in their bike planning. We're generally trying to reach out to the towns that aren't as active because they're the ones who need a little bit more assistance. We're also looking for more for the regional network right now to make those connections. But, you know, we see John Flanlinger on a regular basis, and he'll constantly update us on what's going on. But the town of Orleans is doing a great job, I can tell you right now.
Thank you.
Elizabeth?
Yeah, I had a question. What is the state planning, or where are they in their planning on doing anything on 6A so there's continuity down the whole Cape? Because I know that's been discussed in Brewster because they're going to be coming through and doing the road in a few years, and there have been discussions on sidewalks and bike paths. And there's a limited space, and most people have built into the road layout, and there are trees in the way, and albeit there is still is a major issue of getting pedestrians and bikes down 6A without having to share the road with the cars, which doesn't seem to work out in a very friendly manner most of the time.
Yeah. For as far as the state effort goes, We try to encourage the state to be more global thinking in their approach to Route 6A. It's been more sporadic town by town. We'd like to see the more maybe that overall cross-section for Route 6A that extends along Route 6A, so you do have that continuity from town to town. We haven't been able to get them to buy into that yet. Our approach really for Route 6A, I can tell you, is to have something that's offset Route 6A, and then connections to Route 6A. Again, our focus here is really the bike path network. We're really focusing more on the families. You know, MassDOT will do a nice job when they're upgrading a roadway of putting shoulder facilities on for the serious bikers. The bikers I see along Route 6A, I see the bike teams all the time who aren't afraid to be out in traffic. They seem to do okay with that. So we're really looking to accommodate the families more and the pedestrians with an offset bike path that's really not on 6A. So we're just looking for those opportunities. Yeah, so it's not so encouraging, Elizabeth.
Right.
Good. Yes.
Yeah, I understand, and I know we need a lot more of those connections in Brewster, going from the bike trail to the different businesses. But once people leave the bike trail and take a spur up to a business on 6A, they are most likely going to continue on 6A to go to other businesses. So somewhere along the line, I hope that there's going to be some sort of accommodation or design that'll help with that, so it's a safe transportation method.
I understand.
Thank you.
No more questions?
Do you finish?
I think I'm done.
Okay. Is there anything, any other questions?
Well, thank you for your time.
Thank you. The next item on the agenda is notification of withdrawal of New Generation Wind Joint Venture Project.
Thank you, Roya. For the record, I'm Paige Sapiga, Regulatory Officer with the Commission. I'm here to inform you that the Commission has received a withdrawal request for the New Generation Wind Project. The project proposal consisted of the installation of 6 2.5-megawatt wind turbines and 1 2-megawatt turbine on approximately 400 acres of land in the town of Bourne. On March 1st, the Commission received a letter from Attorney Diane Tillotson, who is representing the applicant, and the letter requested the withdrawal of the project, and you should have a copy of this in your packets. And on March 2nd, the Commission received an email from Ann Gratis. She is a secretary for Bourne's Planning Board. And the email confirmed the project has been withdrawn at the local level, and that is also in your packets. The enabling regulations state that an applicant may withdraw an application for DRI review from consideration by the Commission at any time prior to a Commission vote as long as such withdrawal is in a form approved by the commission, and as long as the applicant provides documentation, the project has also been withdrawn from consideration at the local level. At this time, staff is suggesting that appropriate documentation has been provided to will satisfy both of these requirements, and staff is recommending that the commission vote to accept the withdrawal of the New Generation Wind Project DRI application. I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have, and I know that John Lippman, representing the applicant, is here as well.
Are there any questions? If somebody would like to make that motion.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we accept the withdrawal of the New Generation Wind Joint Venture Project.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
All in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you for all your work, Paige. Next item on the agenda is other business, and we're in the time where the commission must think about establishing a nominating committee for offices for the upcoming year. And any commission members who's interested, if they would please be in contact with Gail Handley and let her know of your interest. And maybe Gail would be willing enough to send a notice out to everybody generally and let everybody respond. Is there any other business? I know there are other items on the agenda, but is there other business?
Roger had his hand up.
Say it again, please.
Roger had his hand up.
Who had their hand up?
Roger.
Mr. Chairman, just a very brief comment.
I just can't looking see you down there. That's all right. Everybody leans forward.
Well, if you're, I don't mind whether you lean forward or not. I had my hand up.
I wasn't thinking about you leaning forward.
Peter saw me down there, so. But my point is very simple. We got sent this stack of paper this last week dealing with the Red Jacket project. Based on what we've experienced with Andrea on some of these water management things, that information sent out to us on a disc probably will save them a number of acres of trees because we just bring it in here and we hand it back to you. The material could be sent to us on a disc. We can run what we want, reprint what we want, and save everybody a lot of time, money, and trees.
Now that is an idea. Joy.
My old computer took
would
discs.
Would you use the microphone, please?
Yes, please. Microphone.
My old computer took discs. My new PC does not. And I have to say, I had this on my passenger seat today with my purse, and my red light went on that I needed to use my seatbelt for my passenger. I had to throw my purse on the floor.
Yeah, anyway. Yes, Ernie.
Well, you know, as much as I disagree with it.
Could you say it louder, please?
As much as I disagree with this process, we do have recycling, so. It's not really going to waste.
If I may, Mr. Chairman, those of us who would like to receive it by disc will probably provide a list to Gail, and those who want to receive the pile of paper can keep it the way it is. How's that?
Well, are we in the decision-making process now? I think that
no.
We might want to refer this to some sort of a committee.
Well, I'm sure we're going to refer it to a committee. Now, the question is, who's going to be on the committee?
Okay.
And volunteers will please raise their hand.
And a notice will be sent to you.
And the meetings will be held at 11 o'clock on Wednesday mornings, somewhere.
Roger to chair.
In the spirit of this organization, I think there might be a need for order. Okay, we have had one Cape Cod Commission comment. Are there any others? Did you want to say something more, Paul? I see you.
Yeah, no, just Roger's point comes up on a regular basis, and in the past we've tried to disseminate information electronically, and then there's always one or two members that insist that it go out the old-fashioned way. But we can take that under advisement and see if there's some way that we can modify the process to make it more user-friendly.
Sometimes people, when they get things electronically, print them out. So, and I, there are people that prefer to read the written word on a piece of paper. I think that's something that needs to be taken into consideration. And also, it's, I would think, if there's a decision-making going on, that, you know, maybe to have something that's easier to reference when you're at a meeting, unless the commission wants to buy us some sort of gadget.
We could buy you all iPads, but then you'd wind up on the front page of the Cape Cod Times.
Turn the pages that way. That would be fun.
How about executive summary?
Yeah. Maybe Roger would like to get some.
Make a donation.
All right. Somebody want to adjourn the meeting?
Do you want a response, Mr. Chairman?
just one last thing before we go. Did the Davenport Development Agreement today, which is a major turning point, I think, for the commission. It's a really important piece of redevelopment. And our chief regulatory officer, Christy Senatore, was recognized by the applicant, but she should also be recognized by the commission for her hard work, not just on the Davenport Agreement, but on the Barnstable Development Agreement that we did a couple months ago. And Christy's going to be taking a short vacation soon. So I want to make sure... that's one way to put it. And I want to make sure that she gets the proper accolades before she departs. So thank you very much, Christy.
And don't forget the Orleans wastewater, too. She's done.
All right. The motion was made that we adjourn. Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Let's go.